Your newfound knowledge for your brand new life, which means more. Cause Hagen's the power, you see that he has thee. No need to worry about your newfound knowledge for your brand new life, which means more. Cause Hagen's the power, you see that he has
somebody
thee.
Told me Hagen's passion was strong. Yeah, I can see that. Said love for his people was long. Yeah, I can feel that. Cause spitting knowledge, then the village was born. Hold on tight, we spitting fire tonight. Destroying lies, renewing lives like never before. He's teaching truth, withholding nothing, leaving you wanting more. He changed my life, uncovered truth that was written on walls. The hieroglyphs in ancient Egypt telling stories of all. Spent lonely nights teaching the fight while gripping on walls. He stands alone, not fearing nothing as he sits on the throne. Keep teaching knowledge, fearing nothing so that we stand tall. The 10th for giant, mighty hero, stacking this one for all, no doubt.
No need to worry about your newfound knowledge for your brand new life, which means more. Cause Hagen's the power, you see that he has thee. No need to worry about your newfound knowledge for your brand new life, which means more. Cause Hagen's the power, you see that he has thee.
Yo, I'm the type that like the scholars to shine. You've never seen a cat like this. His work is truly divine. This year, a dedication, he will always prevail. He chose this life, broke brand new ground here in the ATL. In Missouri, he continues to shine. Oh, ancient one, oh, can you hear me? This is Hagen's high time. Hop in the plane, fly through the air, walk in his shoes. Life will never be fair, no doubt.
Keep reaching, teaching, keep teaching, covering.
It's me, Omuda Kun, I'm vibing mighty and high. Gave me my name, ancestral time, we seeking truth, no more lies. CJ, I love your vocals, they're so silky and smooth. We complement each other's sound, I see you making your moves.
That's right, CJ Afia with the vocals so smooth. Rocking the mic, wish I was there tonight with Omuda Kun.
That's right, we spit that fire, vibing mighty tonight. We pay great homage to the mighty as we slay on the mic, no doubt.
Don't need to worry about your newfound knowledge for your brand new life, which means more. Cause Hagen's the power, you see that he has me. Don't need to worry about your newfound knowledge.
Oh, okay, okay.
Your brand new life, which means more. Cause Hagen's the power, you see that he has me.
Yes, powerful sisters, Queen Theophia and Queen Amita Kuhn. Thank you, sisters, for such a powerful rendition there. Thank you so very much. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you,
man. Ooh, good gracious alive. Ooh, powerful. What can I say? When people just show their appreciation and show their love, it's a wonderful thing. It helps you to live. It lets you know that your life is not in vain. Let's get right into our opening song one more time. God allowed us to come together one more time. I see you, Brother Tom Glenn. Hold that hand up. Come on, everybody. One more time. God allowed us to come together one more time. God allowed us to come together. God allowed us to come together one more time. God allowed us one more time. God allowed us to come together. God allowed us, yeah. Yes. To praise God's name. Just to praise God's name. God allowed us to come together. To praise her name.
praise her name. God allowed us to come together. God allowed us, yeah, yeah. To sing our song. To sing our song. God allowed us to come together. Sing our song. Sing our song. Sing our song. God allowed us to come together. God allowed us, yeah, to come together. To clap our hands. Come on, everybody. To clap our hands. God allowed us to come together. To clap our hands. To clap our hands, to clap our hands. God allowed us to come together. God allowed us, yeah. Everybody say one more time. One more time. God allowed us to come together. One more time, one more time, one more time. Oh, God allowed us, God allowed us, yeah, to come together one more time. God allowed us, yeah, oh, just to praise her name. God allowed us, yeah. God allowed us, yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, yes, she did. God allowed us. God allowed us. God allowed us to come together one more time. One more time, God allowed us to come together one more time. And brothers and sisters, I pray that you don't take that for granted. You know, sometimes, man, it's sad that a lot of us have to get sick or tragedy has to strike or death has to hit our door, you know, before we realize that we shouldn't take it for granted. Every day, you know, that God blessed. This morning when I woke up, man, it was like, God, I thank you for allowing me to see another day in my life that I will never see again. So help me to make the best of today. Yeah. So here we are in another online and GF fellowship, and I'm excited about it, man. You know, let's get right to the oath to the ancestors at this time. All right. Oh, yes. Come on. Let's lift our voices together and honor those who have gone before us and made it possible for us to be today. Let's honor their life, deeds, and legacy and contributions by following these words. Come on, everybody. Oh, ancestors, blacker than a thousand midnights, African ancestors, it is to you that we, your children, give respect and honor. Oh, ancestors, we call upon you and welcome you in this place. African ancestors, let your presence fill this place. Oh, ancestors, who have been purposely excluded from the history books so that the world would not know of your greatness. Our African ancestors, who gave civilization to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave the arts to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave music to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave the sciences to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave mathematics to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave medicine to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave literature to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave philosophy to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave God consciousness to the world. Oh, ancestors, we thank you for devoting your life to make a future for us, your children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. now stand with us, strengthen us, guide us, teach us, and protect us from the snare of our enemies. Rise up, O African ancestors, and let our enemies be scattered, and give us the wisdom and the boldness to deal with our oppressors and those who would hinder the liberation and empowerment of our people. Rise up, O African ancestors, and live in us. And we will not fail to honor you. We will not fail to respect you. We will not fail to hear you. And we will not betray you. Ashe.
And now, brothers and sisters, we want to take the time to honor just a few of the great Africans who have gone ahead of us. We call forth their great African names and honor them to Pharaohs Narmer, Zoja, Sneferu, Khufu, Khafre, Menkaure, and the great vizier great and physician king and multi-genius Imhotep. We say, Ashe. To Queen Nitocris, Queen Sobek Neferu,
African Queen
Ahotep, Queen Amos Neferkar,
yes.
Queen King Hatshepsut, Nefertiti,
yes.
Queen T,
yes.
And Queen Nefertari II, we say, Ashe. To Menkepen Ra Tahuti Maze, known as Thutmosis III, Amenhotep III, Akhenaten, Tutankhamun, Ursama Atra, Setepen Ra, Ramexu Meriamun, Ramses II,
yes.
Shabaka, Taharka, Hannibal, and the great African warrior Shaka Zulu,
yeah.
We say, Ashe. To all of the kings, queens, priests, and warriors of Nubia, Waset, Ethiopia, Kemet, Kenya, the Congo, Tanzania, Uganda, Central, South, and West Al-Kibu land, we say, Ashe.
Yes,
to the more than 600 million Africans whose lives were lost in the European invasions of Africa and in the Middle Passage, we say, Ashe. To the more than 300 million who have since lost their lives to racism and hate crimes, we say, Ashe. To Harriet Tubman,
Ashe.
Frederick Douglass,
Ashe.
Mary McLeod Bethune,
Ashe.
Nat Turner,
Ashe.
Fannie Lou Hamer,
Ashe.
Sojourner Truth,
Ashe.
Carter G. Woodson,
Ashe.
Booker T. Washington,
Ashe.
Dr. Charles Drew,
Ashe.
Noble Drew Ali,
Ashe.
Benjamin Banneker,
Ashe.
George Washington Carver,
Ashe.
Bishop Richard Allen,
Ashe.
Bishop Charles Harrison Mason,
Ashe.
Howard Thurman,
Ashe.
Mother Mahalia Jackson,
Ashe.
The Honorable Marcus Mosiah Garvey,
Ashe.
Benjamin E. May,
Ashe.
Langston Hughes,
Ashe.
Medgar Evers,
Ashe.
Paul Robeson,
Ashe.
Dr. Martin Luther King,
Ashe.
Malcolm X,
Ashe.
Thurgood Marshall,
Ashe.
Mother Clara Hale,
Ashe.
Adam Clayton Powell,
Ashe.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad,
Ashe.
Dr. Amos Wilson,
Ashe.
Dr. John Henry Clark,
Ashe.
Dr. John G. Jackson,
Ashe.
Dr. Shikanta Diop,
Ashe.
Dr. Chancellor William,
Ashe.
Dr. George G.M. James,
Ashe.
Patrice Lumumba,
Ashe.
Kwame Ture,
Ashe.
Kwame Nkrumah,
Ashe.
Dr. Khalid Muhammad,
Ashe.
Dr. Jacob Karedu,
Ashe.
Dr. Ishaka Musa Badashango,
Ashe.
Brother Ray Charles,
Ashe.
To our mothers and fathers,
Ashe.
Our grandmothers and grandfathers,
Ashe.
To our great grandmothers and great grandfathers,
Ashe.
Our brothers and sisters,
Ashe.
Sons and daughters,
Ashe.
Aunts and uncles,
Ashe.
Nieces, nephews,
Ashe.
Cousins,
Ashe.
And all those who have gone ahead of
Ashe.
Us
Ashe.
And have made their ancestral transition
yes.
to their life, Dr. deeds, Dr. legacy, Dr. and contributions, we say,
Ashe.
Ashe. Again, we say, Ashe. Ashe. Again, we
Jackson.
Say, Ashe. Ashe.
Call me white. Our elders have gone on. Yes, Ashe. The English words are these: God is great, and he's worthy to be praised. I say hallelujah. God is great, and he's worthy to be praised. I say hallelujah. God make us one.
we all should be one. And then the unbelievers will come and say, you are with us. God, make us one. We all should be one. And then the unbelievers will come and say, you are with us. Oh, God, make us one. We all should be one. And then the unbelievers will come and say, you are with us. Yeah.
Allahu Akbar. Oh, my brothers and my sisters. Ah, this wonderful man, when we come together as we are right now in fellowship, wherever you are on this planet, here we are on one accord with one another right now. And I'm excited about that. Thank you, brothers and sisters, for taking time out of your schedule to be with me today. I'm glad that you're here. And for those who might have joined in late, I'm Ray Higgins. And hey, man, I'm glad that you're here with me right now. You know, it's a great thing. Yeah. Oh, man, we're in for a treat today. Ah, man, the teaching for today, and I want to go on and set the stage for it now. When I was in Bible college, my Old Testament professor, Dr. Robert Dahl was his name, D-A-H-L. He stood up one day in the class and said, the Bible is an incredible book. That's how he spoke, you know, and I got a kick out of just listening to him talk, you know. And when he said that, I said, amen, in the back of the class, you know. And so he looked at me and he had this look on his face that kind of caught my attention. After the class was over and we were about to leave out of the room, he called me to him. He said, Mr. Higgins, do you know what the word incredible means? I said, yes, I do, doctor. Why? He said, okay, I just want to know. On the way home, that disturbed me so badly that when I got home, I looked at the word incredible. And to my surprise, the word incredible means not credible. See, I always thought that incredible meant credible in an awesome way, right? You know, like, oh, that's incredible, man. Or like, you know, awesome, like just beyond the human mind to grasp it kind of thing, right? You know, no, that's not what incredible means. Incredible means not credible, not dependable, cannot be depended upon. So the next day I went back to class and I asked Dr. Dahl, doctor, why would you say such a thing about the Bible? He said, I see you went home and looked at the word incredible, huh? I said, yes. I said, I'm offended, doctor, that you said that the Bible cannot be counted on. Not trustworthy, not true. That's what the word incredible means. He said to me, Mr. Higgins, why did you come to this school? I said, to learn. He said, do you really want to learn? I said, yes, sir, as long as it doesn't contradict with what I believe. And he looked at me and said, well, Mr. Higgins, you don't really want to learn. I never forgot that. I've carried that with me ever since that day. You know, and when I'm encountering people now who have a problem with what I'm saying, I understand they just don't want to learn. At right now, they just don't want to learn right now. That's all. Okay. Because nothing, I mean, what I'm saying is fact. You can verify it for yourself. Right. So as we get ready to get into today's message, I forgot to honor our supporters and our friends and our members and family everywhere, to everybody who's a part of the African Village, wherever you are. Okay. Let me just do it in a blanket statement right now. Okay. Whether you're in St. Louis at our headquarters, Youngstown, Chicago, Detroit, New York City, Memphis, Tennessee, Charleston, South Carolina, down in the Virgin Islands, in Guyana, South America, in the motherland. If you're on a military base listening to us, wherever you are, thank you for being a part of our experience today.
thank you so very much for being with us, especially you guys right here in the chat room with us, okay? I see the many people who've logged on today waiting for this subject, okay? So let's get ready to get to it, okay? And, of course, before doing that, let me bring this on the screen first, okay? I like to do this, especially with this today's message, right? Let's read what it says. The space inside this circle represents my realm of knowledge. All that I think I know about whatever I think I know is depicted right here within this circle. I must keep in mind that there is more to know than what is within the circumference of my awareness. Keep that in mind. Okay. The reason why I start my teachings off with this illustration is because as a teacher, I know that I'm going to say something outside of your circumference of awareness. If everything I say you already know, then I'm not teaching you anything, right? Then I'm preaching to you. So in order to teach you, I have to explain that which you do not know, make it plain for you. The problem is we have been taught to retaliate and resist, you know, to retaliate against whatever we don't agree with. Anything that's outside of our circumference of awareness, we've been taught to retaliate against it because it doesn't fit into our reticular activating system. Well, brothers and sisters, get ready to learn. Get ready to take notes. I hope you have your Bibles nearby, something to write with, okay? Because today is going to be an eye-opener for many. All right? Okay, having said that, let's move forward here, okay? Why do I teach? Why do I teach? I say this every week. Why do I teach? Why do I stand in front of crowds? Why did I come out of my mother's womb? For what it says right here. All right, to begin the process of undoing and reversing ideas and concepts that have been programmed into the minds of our people by the religious statements and church doctrines that have caused our people to adopt a belief system that has resulted in our loss of contact with what is real, our loss of contact with what is factual, our loss of contact with what is historical, but most of all, our loss of contact with what is spiritual. Yes. Okay. So my job is to return us to the awareness of ourselves. And also remember this, and this is for you religious leaders out there who are convicted by what I'm saying, but you've gained too much from preaching the program, okay, that you don't want to lose what you've gained. So you betray the truth. Remember this, when you've told so many lies on top of each other over the centuries, that telling the truth about one of your early foundational lies would unravel all the lies that have been defensively piled on top of it, thus exposing you for what you truly are, you have no choice but to continue to lie. When your ability to maintain your control over another person's reality is based on the lies about what you are and who they are, you can never tell the truth. Brothers and sisters, today, I'm going to be teaching from this subject, the incredibility of the Bible. One of my most popular messages, the incredibility of the Bible. All right. Having said that, let's get into the message for today. Get ready to take some notes. All right. Be blessed.
I don't know if y'all remember or not, but the Association of Black Collegians had asked if I would participate in a public forum to give the opportunity for open discussion on many of the things that people seem to have a problem with what I'm saying. And of course, I told him I'd be glad to, I'd be honored to, but unfortunately, no other minister came forth. I thought that a little strange because many will stand in their pulpits and try to speak against or whatever. I have to say, and I thought the right thing to do, the African thing to do, would be to have an open public forum so everybody could ask everybody questions. But nonetheless, it didn't happen. And I received quite a bit of feedback from people who stated that they were disappointed because many people were looking forward to the information that would have been presented. The subject of that forum was supposed to be the credibility of the Bible and the origins of Christianity. In all fairness to those who were looking forward to the information, I felt that I should just go ahead and present that information today. But instead of calling today's subject, now I'm not even going to try to put both of those topics in a one-hour lecture. And y'all did hear me say lecture, didn't you?
Yes.
All right, so y'all don't be disappointed if I don't preach.
All right.
This morning, I want to give you some information. I want to give you some knowledge here today, okay? Instead of calling this the credibility of the Bible, I want to call it the incredibility of the Bible. You know, it's really deep, brothers and sisters, because all through Bible college, all through seminary, in my higher schools of learning, I have heard my professors say so many times, the Bible is the most incredible book in the world.
Yeah.
You know, I would hear my professors say, the Bible is just incredible. It's an incredible book. Oh, it's incredible. Mm-hmm. And most times when I have heard that word, I always perceived it as saying it's awesome.
Uh-huh.
It's just that tight. It's just that right. You understand what I'm saying? You know, like when you say, ooh, that's incredible. Mm, that's incredible. Mm. And we take that to mean good. But actually, the word credible is good. Incredible means not good or not true or not valid. You understand what I'm saying? Now you understand where words like that's an incredible lie comes from. You see what I'm saying? During my tenure as a pastor, as an educator, as a lecturer, I have come to realize without doubt in my mind that most people easily believe what they cannot prove.
Say that. Say it now.
And they disbelieve what they cannot disprove.
All right now.
Did y'all grab that? In a minute, we'll grab, digest, swallow it, and let it become a part of our nature, stuff that we cannot prove as fact. But stuff that has evidence to it, we don't want to believe it. This is especially true when it comes to the religious doctrinology that has been programmed since childhood into the minds of many sincere church folk today. And even non-church folk. Many people believe in what is called the verbal plenary inspiration of the scriptures. In other words, that's just the theological way of saying that the entire Bible, from Genesis to the book of the Revelation, word for word, was given by God to his prophets, apostles, and servants. Most church people believe that. So that you can see where this is taken from, if you will, turn in your Bibles to 2 Peter. The first chapter, the 21st verse. 2 Peter, the first chapter, the 21st verse. When you have it, say Ashe. If you don't have it, say not yet. The not yets have it. 2 Peter 1:21. Got to say Ashe. All right. Notice what the Bible says. It says, for the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Now, theologians and seminarians have taken this verse to say that the Bible is inspired from cover to cover, even though it doesn't say that. That's what they made it say. And they've coupled this verse that we've just read to another verse in 2 Timothy. If you turn there, a few pages backward to 2 Timothy, the 3rd chapter and the 16th verse. When you have it, say Ashe. It says these words, 2 Timothy 3:16. It says, all scripture. Is that what your Bible says?
Yes.
It says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for what?
Doctrine.
Doctrine, for reproof, for correction, or for instruction in righteousness.
All right.
Now, because those two words in that verse say all scripture, people have mistaken this verse to say the whole Bible. Follow what I'm saying. When Timothy so-called wrote this letter, I'm sorry, Paul to Timothy, he was telling Timothy, all scripture is given by inspiration of God, right? In his letter. But now, what makes you think that Paul was talking about the letter that he was writing? He was trying to, according to this text, inform Timothy about the scriptures being the words of God. Nothing in his writing implies in any way, shape, or form that Paul was talking about the letter that he was writing. Therefore, the person who calls himself or herself a Christian is taught to believe in these things. One, the uniqueness of the Bible. That means that there's no other book on the planet like it. No other book on the planet says what the Bible says. It's called the uniqueness of the Bible. Christians are taught about the infallibility of the Bible, meaning that if the Bible says it, you can take it to the bank. Christians are taught something else called the inerrancy of the Bible, which is the claim that the Bible does not have any errors in it. Yeah, yeah. It's flawless. Another doctrine of the Bible that most Christians are taught is something called the genuineness of the Bible. It's genuine in its origin. The credibility, meaning that it can be counted on. It's true. And something called the authenticity, meaning that it is authentic. It is the true, authentic word of God. This is what most church folk are programmed to believe. And guess when this program begins? When they are two,
yes, sir,
three, four years old. In fact, children at 2, 3, 4 years old who don't know how to read are taught to pledge their allegiance,
yes,
to a book they don't even know how to read. Little children are made to say in many churches, "I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, and hide its words in my heart that I might not sin against God." But yet they can't read it. That's deep. To pledge your allegiance and commitment to something you don't understand. But look at the person next to you and say, "That's how the program works." Deal very quickly with something called the authorship of the Bible. Most people have been taught that the Bible was written by approximately 40 different authors,
yes,
over a period of 1600 years.
Yes,
that's what I was taught. All in Sunday school, in Bible Institute, in Bible college, in seminary, they teach you that under the doctrine of inspiration that 40 men wrote the Bible, not a woman. They left them out for some reason or another. They taught us that 40 men wrote the Bible over a period of 1600 years, and not one of them contradicted the other. But the truth is, brothers and sisters, that the Bible as we know it, how did I say that?
The Bible
as we know it just came into existence in 1611. What we call the King James version of the Bible came into existence in 1611. Under the auspices and by order of Jimmy Stewart. That was his name, y'all, in case y'all didn't know that. James Stewart, okay, who ordered 47 scholars, so-called scholars, of which William Shakespeare happened to have been one of them, and another man who was William Shakespeare's lover, named Francis Bacon. Don't get offended, I'm just telling you the truth. You see how we've been so religiosized, if that's a word? You dig? I mean, like, you know, I tell you that these two men were gay and they were contributors to the Bible and you got offended. Some of you. Ain't my fault. King James was kind of messed up himself. He was a sick human being. Tell it like it is. The man killed his lovers after he was finished with them. Had his own mother put to death because she dared tell him that he was wrong. So he commissioned 47 so-called scholars in the year 1600. See the similarity? We were taught 40 authors over a period of 1600 years. But the truth is, King James commissioned 47 authors in the year 1600 to compile the Bible that we now have, and they completed the work in 1611. Oh, it's deep. For many people in the world, the Bible is held to be the final authority in all matters. Out of 1,001 different sects, S-E-C-T-S, and denominations of Christianity, there are many different reasons why the Bible holds the position it does. One of the ultimate questions that is asked to anybody, now y'all might get this question if you haven't gotten it already. They will ask you this question. Well, do you believe the Bible is the Word of God? That's all I want to know. And you try to explain to them, I want to know, do you believe the Bible is the Word of God? Answer me, do you believe the Bible is the Word of God? That's the context here. And see, when people ask you that question, all they want to hear from you is a yes or a no. That's all they want to hear. Now, the problem with that is this. When it comes to the Bible, we must realize that things are not always so black and white, as we would say. Between the two extremes are a lot of shades of gray. If one says, yes, I believe the Bible is the Word of God, you know what that means? That means then that you are ready to swallow every word it says, hook, line, and sinker. If you say no to that answer, far as they are concerned, this conversation is over. I don't want to hear nothing you got to say because you don't believe the Bible is the Word of God. So that's the kind of predicament we're in this program. In fact, they'll call you Antichrist.
Yes.
We must always remember that the word Bible is not in the Bible. Okay? Bible, the word Bible, is from the Latin word biblios, which means little book. Whenever the Bible refers to the ancient scriptures, it's always talking about the Old Testament or even earlier than that. I better say that again.
Yeah.
It's always talking about the Old Testament or earlier than that. Never do you hear the word scriptures used with reference to what is called the New Testament. Because when these references were made, the only thing that existed at the time were the ancient sacred writings. Let's deal with the concept, the Word of God. How many of you have heard that the Bible is the Word of God? You've heard that before? All right. The ancient term, ancient African term, metuneta, translated into English means, metu means word or words, neta meaning God or gods. So when we say the metuneta, we're saying the word of God or the words of the gods. But do y'all know what the metuneta really is? Metuneta is not what some white people wrote from Europe. I better say that one more time for y'all. In fact, let me just jump ahead for a moment and let y'all know. There is not one line of scripture anywhere in the world written by a white man. I better say it one more time. Because see, I know that a lot of folk here still have this thing. You know, we automatically think that white is something. I'm still trying to grab that. You know, many have this. unexplainable respect for white still. So I think you need to understand that the only thing that the white man compiled when it comes to the biblical message is the commentaries and the theological concepts and perspectives that have misused verses in the Bible. Y'all follow what I'm saying? The ancient sacred writings were written long before the white man even came out of the caves. You need to understand this. Now, I hope that wasn't too hard for somebody, because I promised somebody on this week I'd try to take it easy on white folk. But I'm going to tell it like it is. They're still liars. That's the message from last week. These were the ancient writings inscribed in stone, also called by the white man hieroglyphics. Now follow this, brothers and sisters. The word hieroglyphics or hieroglyphs is a compound word. Two word, hieroglyphs. Hiero means sacred. Glyphs means writings. So when you see the word hieroglyphics, you're actually saying the sacred writings. We've been taught, and I'm sure most of you know, that what we call the writings of ancient Egypt, we've been calling it the hieroglyphics. The real name is the Metuneta. And you can see that clearly in my tape, African Evidence That Demands an African Verdict. I actually got it right there, the pyramid text of ancient Egypt, where all of the sacred writings were copied and stolen from and put in what we now call the Bible. Right out of the pyramid of Teti the First in Saqqara. On this basis, we must understand that the inspired text, came from Egypt. What did I say, y'all?
Egypt.
I didn't say wrong.
No, sir. Egypt.
I don't care how much power the Pope thinks he has. Nothing inspired came out of Rome. One more time. How many of y'all in here were raised as Catholics? Let me see your hand. Okay, let me reiterate it one more time. Nothing inspired came out of Rome. Guess what else, people? For those who want to assume a Jewish identity, nothing inspired came out of Jerusalem either.
All right.
Prove me wrong. The ancient texts came from the sacred writings of the true Holy Land, which is what we call today Kemet or Egypt. Pastor, why are you bringing all this out? Because the only way we're going to be liberated is we got to understand how we've been lied to. As long as you don't understand the lie, you're going to keep operating within the parameters of the lie. Once you see clearly the lie, then you'll step yourself up out of the lie. You understand? Woo, buddy. When it comes to the Bible, there are three kinds of literary witness that's easy to recognize. One is what's called the Word of God. Mm-hmm. Let me give you an example of what that is. Turn to Deuteronomy. I'm not saying that what we're about to read is the Word of God. I'm not saying that. I'm just giving you an example. Okay? Because see, when you see how these imposter Jews have compiled this thing for their benefit, Deuteronomy 18, starting at the 17th verse. Notice what the Bible says. Deuteronomy 18, 17. Deuteronomy is the fifth book of the Bible. You have it, say Ashe. It says, and the Lord said unto me, they have well spoken that which they have spoken. Mm. And the Lord said unto me, and here supposed to be the words of God, they have well spoken that which they have spoken. I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren like unto thee, and will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto them all that I shall command him. Now that's an example of God speaking. I didn't say it was God speaking. Y'all follow me clearly here. I didn't say it was God speaking, but since many of us are still Bible bound, let me give you an example from the Bible of what we would call the words of God speaking. Here he said, this is what the Lord said, and boom. The second witness would be considered to be the words of a prophet of God. Okay, let's look at Joshua, the 6th chapter. Next book over.
Yes.
Joshua, the 6th chapter, verse 6 and 7. You have it, say Ashe.
Ashe.
All right, no problem. Just say, wait a minute. I thought that's just as good. Joshua 6 and 6. When you have it, say Ashe. That's a little bit more. Still got to wait. All right, notice what it says. And Joshua, the son of Nun, what did he do?
Called
the priests and said unto them, what did Joshua say?
Take up the ark of the covenant.
Okay, you ain't got to read no more. You get the point. In other words, in this verse, Joshua is not saying, the Lord said unto me, blah. This is Joshua talking here, according to this verse. Okay? The third witness is what we call the words of a historian. Oh, follow it as well now. Look at Mark, second book of the New Testament. Mark, the 1st chapter, verse 21 through 28. Now, what's really deep about this, as you read this type of witness, I want you to pay close attention. The book of Mark, the 1st chapter, the 21st verse. You have it, say Ashe. It says, and they went into Capernaum.
Yeah.
And straightway on the Sabbath day, he entered into the synagogue and taught.
Yeah.
And they were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one who had authority and not as one of the scribes. Now, what's deep about this is, here we have a third person writer. Follow me now. The persons who are involved in this account is not the person who's writing this. In fact, we have here, what book is this?
Mark.
Mark was a what we would almost call a knee baby at the time that this would have occurred. So Mark was writing what somebody told him happened. Are you following what I'm saying? So you cannot take the words of a historian and say that it is the word of God. You have the word of God, you have the words of God's prophet speaking, and then you have the word of a historian. And what's really deep, brothers and sisters, is over 80% of the Bible fits into the third category that we just read. The word of a hearsay evidence.
Yeah.
All right now.
In a court of law, hearsay don't mean nothing.
That's right.
Yes, sir.
As far as the issue of the credibility of the Bible is concerned, the rule of thumb is real simple. Everybody say this with me. A book,
especially a sacred book,
is credible
if it relates truthfully
the matters
on which it addresses.
Now, brother pastor, what are you saying? I'm saying this, that any writing is credible if it's telling the truth.
Yeah.
Real simple. But once you misrepresent the text It is not credible. Well, Brother Pastor, are you saying that there's been stuff that's been misrepresented in the Bible? Let's find out. First point I want to bring out is something called the false attribution of the scriptures.
Come on, preach up.
We want to write that down. For an example, I'll use the example we used Wednesday night in Bible classes just to ask the question about Isaiah 7:14. Turn there right quick. Isaiah, the 7th chapter, the 14th verse. Let's look at this real good. Y'all ready for this? I don't know, man. If y'all ain't ready, I'll stop now. I just lied to y'all. Forgive me. I ain't gonna stop. If y'all ain't ready, get ready. I'm not gonna stop. I got to teach you the truth. Isaiah 7:14. Say it with me. Isaiah 7:14. I'm gonna read this verse, and right quick, I want some feedback from y'all. Here it is now. Listen carefully. Therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel. What have you been taught that verse is talking about? Jesus' virgin birth, right? Haven't you been taught that? We've been taught that that's a prophecy of the virgin birth of Jesus. Now let me show you what I mean by false attribution, so that you'll know what false attribution is. False attribution is to say that the Bible says something that it doesn't say. And make it doctrine. Keep your finger right there, okay? Turn to Matthew, the 1st chapter, right quick. Let's deal with this thing here. Matthew, the 1st chapter, the 21st verse. This is where the angel visited Mary in this text. Matthew 1:21. You have it? Say Ashe. Here's what it says. Read it with me. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name
Jesus.
Wait a minute. Call him what?
Jesus.
Call him Jesus, right?
Yeah.
For he shall save his people from their sin. Now notice the 22nd verse carefully, people. Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, notice what it said, behold, a virgin shall be with child and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. So you see in Matthew, the 1st chapter, they are saying, I'm not saying the Bible says it. They, the compilers, the theologians, the programmers, are saying that Jesus being born in the 1st chapter of Matthew is the fulfillment of Isaiah 7:14. Do y'all see that?
Yes.
I don't want to lose you now. Y'all see that?
Yes.
Well then let's go back over to Isaiah 7:14.
Right,
one more time, I'm gonna read that verse. Therefore the Lord himself shall give you, put a circle around the word you. Because see, the first mistake, y'all think that you is you.
All right.
First mistake, right off the bat. Who is the you in this verse?
All right, sir.
The Lord shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son. Put a circle around the word virgin.
Yeah.
There are two words for the word virgin in the Hebrew. The first word is Alma.
Come on, preach up.
A-L-M-A-H, and the second one is Bethula. How many of y'all ever heard of a woman named Alma before?
Yeah.
Alma simply means young maiden. Doesn't mean a woman who's never been touched before. Bethula means a woman who's never been touched by man.
Yeah.
So you got two Hebrew words for the one English word virgin. In this verse, the Hebrew word is Alma. A-L-M-A-H, which means a young maiden. Now let's read it with that right meaning. Behold, a young maiden shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel. Notice the next verse. Butter and honey shall he eat. Nowhere in the Bible do we read of Jesus eating butter and honey. Oh, yeah. That he may know to refuse the evil and choose the good. Now notice the 16th verse. For before the child shall know to refuse the evil and choose the good, the land that thou abhorrest shall be forsaken of both her kings. What in the world is this talking about? What is this talking about? See, it's easy to make the Bible say what you want it to say if you're going to snatch a verse out of its context and fit your doctrine. And that's what they have done. This is not a prophecy about a virgin birth of Jesus. This is a prophecy to Ahaz. Look at the 10th verse. Moreover, the Lord spake again unto who?
Ahaz.
So now you know who the you is.
Yeah.
In Isaiah 7:14, Ahaz was in war and he thought he was going to lose the war. So God sent Isaiah to Ahaz and said, listen, don't worry. I ain't going to let you be defeated in battle. Ahaz said, I'm going to lose this battle. So Isaiah said in the 10th verse, man, listen, ask God for a sign. Ask him for a sign. What, the 12th verse somewhere on there?
Yeah.
I'm not going to ask God for no sign, Ahaz says in the 12th verse. 13th verse, Isaiah says, I'm tired of y'all people.
Yeah.
Y'all getting all freaked out, nervous and everything instead of just trusting God. 14th verse, he says, listen, God's going to give you a sign anyhow.
Uh-huh.
A young maiden is going to get pregnant. And she's going to bear a child, and his name is going to be Emmanuel, which means God with us, which is a sign to you, Ahaz, that when you go into battle, God will be with you. That's what this is. And if you look at the 8th chapter, the very next chapter, the 3rd verse, it tells you who the child was. It says, and I went unto the prophetess, and what did it say, people? And she conceived and did what? And bare a son. In other words, this son was Isaiah's son. The virgin was Isaiah's wife. Let's deal with something else. Let's deal with contradictions. Incredibility. Y'all don't mind this, do you? I got to take the sunglasses. I got to take the blinders off you. Contradiction. The biblical text clearly states two different genealogies for Jesus. Let me ask y'all a question. How many inconsistencies do you need before you come to the realization that something is not infallible? How many? Just one inconsistency, right? One contradiction, right?
Yes, sir.
Let's go to Matthew, the 1st chapter. Matthew, the 1st chapter, the 16th verse. When you have it, say Ashe. It says, and Jacob begot Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus, who is called Christ. Do y'all see that?
Yes.
According to that verse, who is Jesus' granddaddy?
Jacob,
right? Yeah. Joseph is Jesus' daddy, and Jacob is his granddaddy, right? Jacob is Joseph's father, right? All right, now look at Luke, the 3rd chapter.
Also,
look at Luke, the 3rd chapter, the 23rd verse. When you have it, say Ashe. And Jesus himself began to be about 30 years of age, being, as was supposed, the son of Joseph, which was the son of who? I thought y'all said Jacob. Thought y'all said Jacob was Jesus' granddad. According to this verse, Heli is his granddad. So you say, well, that's a different cultural name, maybe. You know, let's deal. All right, then in that case, while you're in the third chapter of Luke, let's run on up the list, because all these different names are different from the first one. But let's go to where it comes back round to look at the 31st verse. Uh-huh. Which was the son of Meliah, which was the son of Menon, which was the son of Matata, which was the son of Nathan, which was the son of David. Now, in this verse, who's David's son? So Nathan, in this verse, is a great, 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 granddaddy of Jesus, right?
All right.
Okay, let's go back to Matthew, the first chapter. And look at the sixth verse. Matthew 1 and 6. And Jesse begat David, the king. And David the king begat who? Wait a minute now. We just read Nathan was David's son. Now who is it? Solomon or Nathan? Who is Jesus' granddaddy? Jacob or Eli? I'm going to tell y'all right now. Don't lose no sleep over it. It's a contradiction that you will never reconcile. It's an inconsistency. How about this? How many of y'all have ever heard of a jigsaw puzzle before?
Yeah.
I don't know if y'all like putting jigsaw puzzles together. It's a nice, you know, thing to do, waste time. But if you have a supposedly a 500 piece jigsaw puzzle, right? And when you pour all the puzzle pieces out on the table and start trying to put that thing together, you don't know it. But there's only 342 pieces there. Are you going to ever put that puzzle together? You never put it together, will you? And what's sad about it is you will put all this time into trying to find out what piece goes where and putting it together, and you might get about 20-something pieces together in a little section that you found, and you start saying, oh, I'm beginning to see this thing now. And based on the little bit of the puzzle that you did put together, you think you got the whole picture. That's what's going on with us.
Yeah, that's right. Good example.
We have been told only parts of what has been plagiarized. Am I making sense, people? How are you going to get the whole picture when you intentionally remove some of the pieces from the puzzle? Well, there's some books that they removed. What makes you say that, Pastor? Let's find out. Yeah. Turn to Numbers 21:14. Yeah. How can it be credible when I got these omissions here? Numbers 21:14. When you get it, say Ashe. Not yet. All right. Numbers 21:14. Notice what it says. Wherefore it is said, read it, people, what does it say?
In the book of the what?
In the book of the wars of the Lord. Where is that book?
Took it out.
Where is it? What information is contained in that book that might give you some more puzzle pieces to their program? The book evidently must have existed, right? I mean, let's put it this way. Right here in the Bible, it refers to that book. So it ain't like I'm making up that name. Let's look at another one. Turn to Joshua, a couple of more books over, 10th chapter, the 13th verse. Turn quickly now, I'm running out of time. I'm going to start reading. And the sun stood still and the moon stayed until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is this not written in the book of what? Jasher. Jasher. Where is that book?
It's missing. Somebody stole it.
Where is the book of Jasher? I want to see what contents, what information is there. Oh, y'all, let's look at another one. Turn to 1 Chronicles 29. No, in fact, 1 Chronicles 29, 29. 1 Chronicles 29, 29. Now, some of y'all didn't know nothing about these books. Just like a lot of y'all didn't know Moses' daddy's name. And see, they didn't tell you Moses' daddy's name for a reason.
That's right.
Because, see, Moses' daddy was also Moses' first cousin. Moses' daddy married his aunt. And she gave birth to Moses and Aaron. So Moses' children were also his first cousins. It's called incest, y'all. They don't want you to know that the great teacher of the Hebrew people came here through incest. So they just don't tell you about Amram. A-M-R-A-M. That was Moses' daddy, y'all. According to the biblical text. Notice 1 Chronicles 29:29. Now the acts of David the king, first and last, behold, are they not written in the book of Samuel the seer? Where's that book? And in the book of Nathan the prophet? Where's the book of Nathan? And the book of Gad the seer? There are three more books. Right there. Where are they? The Bible refers to them. Turn over to the next book, 2 Chronicles 9:29. A few more pages over to the 9th chapter of the next book. 29th verse. Now the rest of the acts of Solomon, first and last, are they not written in the book of Nathan the prophet? And then the prophecy of Ahiah, the Shalomite, and the visions of Edo? Where's the book of the visions of Edo? What is contained in these books that might tell us the truth about the liar? See, usually when there's something they don't want you to see. Let me close, y'all. I'll be honest with you, I could go on the rest of the day. But I'm almost out of tape. Let's deal with this last thing called interpolations.
Yes.
To interpolate means to polish, to dress up, to alter, to change it, to enlarge it, or to corrupt it.
Yes.
By putting in new words, by putting in new subject matter.
Yes.
As an example, and the first interpolation that I can think of is Mark, the 16th chapter. Everybody turn there. Second book of the New Testament. Now, I'm gonna close on this. This will be enough right here. Like I said, there's so much more that I could share with you. But the first thing I must do to liberate you from captivity is show you the true nature of your captors. Did y'all hear what I said? In order to liberate you from captivity, you must see and understand, whether you like it or not, the true nature of your captors. In Mark 16, the 8th verse, it says, and they went out quickly and fled from the sepulchre, for they trembled and were amazed. Neither said they anything to any man, for they were afraid. Do y'all see that?
Yes, yes.
Now, let me see the hands of people in this room who's got some more verses in their Bible for this chapter? Raise your hand if there's some more verses there. In other words, after the eighth verse, is there a ninth, 10th, 11th, 12th version? There's some more verses? All the way to 20, huh? Now this is deep, people. Let me tell you what's deep about this. Follow this well. Mark stops at the end of the eighth verse.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now, I don't know what kind of Bibles y'all have in here today, but is there anybody in here who has a Bible with the notation at the end of the eighth verse? Is there anybody here that got a notation at the end of the eighth verse, like an NIV, New International Version of the Bible? Anybody got that here? You don't have your? Okay, I'll lift mine. All right, is there anybody that got a footnote about verses 9 through 20 in their Bible? You got one, D?
I have it. I got to have it.
You have it? What does it say?
No, I've got it. I've got it at the point. I got to have it.
It actually says that?
No.
Oh, you put it in there. Now, I want somebody whose Bible actually says it. Nobody's Bible actually says that? What kind of Bibles y'all got? Y'all just got devotional reading Bibles. There's just, you know, see, y'all, that's why you need study Bibles. So when you're dealing with the that's deep. Nobody's Bible says this? Verses 9 through 20. There should be a notation somewhere in your Bible, maybe at the bottom of the page somewhere. Oh, you got one, Linda? Look, read it nice and loud. What does it say? The earlier manuscripts and some other ancient witnesses, what does it say? Do not have Mark 16, 9 through 20. Thank you. Now there it is right there in the book. The scholars know it. So then how did verses 9 through 20 get in there? Somebody added them in there. That's called interpolation. Now, what's deep about it, people, what y'all don't understand, is it was added somewhere between the 4th and 6th century. Now, I'm getting ready to drop something on y'all that's going to blow your mind. Who in here has a red letter edition of the Bible? Now, I see some hands. Y'all got those words of Jesus in red, don't you? Now, this is deep. Now we're going to read verses 9 through 20. I'm going to read them real fast. But as I read them, I want you to keep in mind, even though a lot of these words are in red letters in your Bible, keep in mind that these were added centuries later, so Jesus couldn't have said it. Verse 9 through 20. Now, when Jesus was risen early in the first day of the week, first thing we got right off the bat is it says, now when Jesus was risen. In other words, we don't even hear about the resurrection story until they add these verses. The first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven devils. 10th verse. And she went and told them that had been with him as they mourned and wept. 11th verse. And they, when they heard that he was alive and had seen her, been seen of her, believe not. 12th verse. After that, he appeared in another form unto two of them as they walked and went into the country. 13th verse. And they went and told it unto the residue, neither believed they them. 14th verse. Afterward, he appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat and upbraided them with their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. 15th verse. Now, this is what's deep. This is deep, people. 15th verse. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world. Keep in mind now, this wasn't there. This was added. This is called false attribution. In other words, somebody decided to put these words in Jesus' mouth. You don't have to take my word for it. Go liberate yourself. Look at the person next to you and say, set yourself free. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. 17th verse, and this is from a Pentecostal brothers and sisters. And these signs shall follow them that believe. For in my name they shall cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Oh, this is deep. Because those couple of verses I just read is the second foundational pillar to the Pentecostal church. So then after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. Says who? And they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. Amen.
Amen.
The Egyptians pronounce it amen. Brothers and sisters, I hope that you will take the information you've heard today and don't take it as information to go out and tell other people they're wrong. That's not why I shared this information with you. I share this information with you to liberate you from the grasp of your oppressor. Because the very thing that your oppressor has been using is the very thing that you don't want to back away from. And that's the belief system that they gave you. If we as a people are going to ever be free, we're going to have to first realize that we knew God long before the white man had an awareness that he was even alive. Y'all hear what I'm saying? It amazes me how a people who have at least a 75,000 year history can all of a sudden not know who God is and be lost and undone and on their way to hell until they believe what somebody who just came out of the caves a few thousand years ago want to make you believe. As long as you keep buying into that mess, you will always be a slave. You will look like an African. You may even learn how to speak Kiswahili. You may understand the Metuneta and how to read it backward and forward. But as long as you're still stuck in their parameters of thinking, you're still a slave.
Mm-hmm.
And whenever they get ready, they will give you orders. And you will say, your order shall be obeyed. Without even realizing you're saying it. And guess what, brothers and sisters? They do it. Every time we start coming together as a people, they pull their little strings in our psycho viscera. And then the first thing you want to come and say, but do you believe in Jesus? Isn't that deep? We can come together on everything else. That one little line, that one question divides us.
Yep.
It's time for our resurrection and empowerment.
Wow, family. It's time for our resurrection and empowerment. I know that much of the message today, for those of you who are still there, okay, I know it rubbed you hard, rubbed you wrong. It probably was very disturbing to many of you, especially those of you who are Bible believers. Okay, I was there. I used to be there. Okay. But I learned more, you know, it's really amazing, man, how many of us literally are afraid to learn. Isn't that deep? Did you not know that knowledge is the forbidden fruit? Of every tree in the garden thou mayest freely eat, except from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Why wouldn't God want you to know? God designed your brain to know, to analyze, you know? But no, we want to just believe. Yeah, that's not the way of our people. That's not the way of our ancestors. That's what was given to us to remove us from our power. Okay? When you've been given to something to believe in that doesn't even exist, and you want to know why our lives are not better, because you've been given a placebo. I'm gonna let you look that up on your own. For those who don't know what a placebo is, it's spelled P-L-A-C-E-B-O, placebo. Okay, check it out. And what's even deeper than that is to apply the meaning of placebo to what you've been given to believe in, or to who you've been given to believe in. Yeah. Family, I pray that you were blessed, that you learned from today's message. And for the trolls who felt like I'm the devil himself teaching and wanted to disrespect the room, you notice you were blocked. Well, you probably can't hear me because you were blocked, right? That's what we're doing that now, family. Okay, I have no more tolerance for people who do not want to learn in my class. You don't come to my classroom to try to find what I said that's wrong, or because you disagree. If you don't agree with what I'm saying, then don't come. Real simple. I'm here to teach those who want to know, and knowledge is for those who seek it. Understand that. Okay. Yeah. I'm not at that age anymore where I got the energy and strength to just go to war with somebody because they just want me to convince them. No, those days are over with. I teach. Take it or leave it. It's up to you. Okay. Prove me wrong. That's why I say don't take my word for what I'm saying. Do your own research. Okay. All of the insertions that you saw in today's message, I put that there so you can see what it says in your Bible. Got me? Yeah, man. Okay. Well, brothers and sisters, let me do this now. For those of you who are listening to us there on YouTube, go ahead and subscribe. Okay. In fact, I see the numbers there. I want everybody that's watching right now, even if you've already done it, hit that like button. Okay, hit that like button. Just go on and hit it, just because I'm asking you to, okay? Even if you've hit it already, give me some thumbs up in there, right? Got to get our numbers up, all right? Hit that like button there, okay? And if you have not subscribed to the channel, please go ahead and subscribe, okay? See, as a subscriber, when I go live, you'll get a notification, okay, as to when I go live. Or hit the notification bell, something like that, one of the two. Subscribe and hit the notification bell. Do both of them, all right? Just to be on the safe side, okay? Family, I've enjoyed being with you guys today. As always, thank you so very much for being with me. Of course, we invite you to log on to our website, theafricanvillage.org. Not WBLR.com anymore, okay? We lost that. Okay, I'm trying to get it back, but we lost that for now. Right now, just go to our website, theafricanvillage.org. The African, T-H-E, africanvillage.org. And that's African with a K, not a C. Okay, theafricanvillage.org, O-R-G. All right, when you go there, all right, you'll see the site is still under construction, but you'll see, scroll down a little bit, you'll see a big play arrow. Just hit that arrow, click that arrow, and you'll hear me teaching 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Okay, so those of you who said you want to sit under me and learn, go to my radio station and just learn. Doesn't cost you anything. It costs me, but it don't cost you, all right? Okay, yeah, man, so let's go on and learn. Yeah, learn. If you really want to learn, okay, it's there for you. Any time of day or night, just get some pen and a paper and just learn. Get your Bible, take notes, learn. Okay? Yeah, buddy. All right, let's go here now And those of you who want to make your donations to help us with that, I appreciate it. Okay. And by the way, as I said on last week, let me say it again, because I don't know if this is if it's scammers out there or what, but I'm getting an inordinate amount of people requesting money in Cash App. Okay, so brothers and sisters, those of you who are using Cash App, okay, be sure you're pressing the right button or clicking on the right button, okay? You want to send funds, not ask for funds. We don't give out money because we don't have money to give out. Okay, real simple. All right, we're trying to pay our bills, man, you know. And of course, every week we come up short. So I have to make up for the lack myself. But it's okay. We're going to do that if we have to, you know, one way or another. We're just going to keep on doing what we got to do to get this message out there. Okay. There are some Sundays when you guys give, the donations are enough to cover the expenses for that week. And I you have no idea how much I appreciate that. Then there are other Sundays you guys give, and I don't complain because I believe you're giving, I believe you're doing the best you can. Okay. Even those of you who give a dollar, I believe that you're doing the best you can. However, if a dollar is the best that you can do, then I suggest that you hold on to it because you need it more than I do. Got me? Okay. Please don't take that wrong. We appreciate whatever you give. Okay. If it's 5 cents, we appreciate it. Okay. But the thing is, giving 5 cents is going to cost you more to give it than the 5 cents itself. You know, with the fees they charge for everything now, you know? Okay. So in your giving today, if you're giving through Cash App, you see the cash tag, Dr. Ray Hagen's address there. Cash tag Dr. Ray Hagen's if you're giving through at Cash Tag, through Cash App. If you're giving through Zelle, it's my email address, rayhagens@gmail.com. Okay. One G in my name. rayhagens@gmail.com. If you're making your donation through Zelle. If you're sending your donation through the mail, okay, then make your check of money or order out to the African Village and mail it to 3520 North Newstead Avenue, St. Louis, Missouri, 63115. Okay. Got those addresses? Cool. All right. Also, brothers and sisters, I got a special announcement I want to share with you guys, and that is coming up February the 3rd. Let's see if I can make this any bigger. I don't know if I take myself off the screen, you might not hear me. Okay, coming up February the 3rd, okay, which is in a couple of weeks, to all of you in the DMV area, that's D.C., Maryland, Virginia, all of you in that tri-state area there, listen, I'll be coming there to teach at the, let me do this because I saw on my screen here, but I can't hardly see that. And my eyes ain't what they used to be. As old folks, they used to say, pray the Lord, my eyes ain't what they used to be, pray the Lord. Okay, I will be teaching at the E-Life Restaurant at 9033 Central Avenue, Capitol Heights, Maryland. That's Saturday, February the 3rd. Okay, the doors will open at 6 p.m. The lecture will start at 6:30. All right. And for more information, okay, let me put a number here for you guys, okay, that you can call. All right. 301-324-6900. Okay. Let me put that on the screen. If you want more information, call that number, okay, and talk with Dr. Baruch, my brother and my friend there in Baltimore. Okay, he's the one who called and asked if I would come and give this lecture. And I pretty much kind of stopped traveling and giving lectures with my health and all, you know, and my age. You know, we got to, what's that song says, got to know when to hold them, know when to fold them, know when to walk away, know when to run, right? Well, some people don't know when to stop, OK? Okay, I'm at the age now, I'm not as young as I used to be, so I can't be running all over the country like I used to, all right? But when Dr. Baruch called me, I said, man, I will be there for you, definitely. You know, we're gonna, I mean, that's my friend, that's my brother. We go way back, man, doing work together. So, you know, some people you just sacrifice for, okay? And Dr. Baruch is one of those people, all right? So if you're in the Baltimore, Washington, Virginia area, come on out and be with us there, okay? Again, that's the E-Life Restaurant, 9033 Central Avenue, Capitol Heights, Maryland. And that's February the 3rd at 6 p.m. The doors open at 6 o'clock. The number to call for more information is 3, as you see it there on the screen, 301-324-8. I'm sorry, not 8900. It's 6900. Oh boy, that's what happens, man. When you type in too fast. Okay, let me do that again. 301-324-6900. Man, how'd I do that? Russian, okay, Russian. Okay, that's the right number to call. 301-324-6900. I had 8900 there. And I ain't got my glasses on, so that 6 looked like an 8. I don't know. Oh boy. Getting old is something else. It's really a deep experience, you know? Okay. But those of you there in the Baltimore area, come on and be with me that weekend. Okay. Come on and be with me that weekend. It'd be good to see you guys. I haven't been up there in a while. Be good to see y'all. Okay. Yeah. Also, brothers and sisters, you know, I want to talk about this organization here, the Black Achievement Fund. If you're not a member, if you haven't joined yet, come on and join. Okay, come on and join. And Brother Black, please email me, all right? My email address, okay? Brother Black, I believe, oh God, is the name John? I believe it's John. Okay, Black. Brother Black, email me, man. I got some information for you, okay? Ray Hagins, that's H-A-G-I-N-S, @gmail.com. Send me an email. Please do. All right? Okay, brother. And it's pertaining to the Black Achievement Fund. So just email me. Okay. And those of you out there, $9 a month. $9 a month. Okay? 1 million people giving $9 a month will give us over $1 billion a year. Wouldn't that be a nice platform to help our people with? Yeah, that we don't have to ask nobody for anything. We can come to our own and get whatever we need for our people. That's the purpose of the Black Achievement Fund. I encourage you to log on to the BAF.solutions. That's the website for the Black Achievement Fund. See you there, bottom page, baf.solutions. Go there at the top of the hour at 2 o'clock, okay, and listen to a presentation from our president and founder, Brother R.K. Hodges, as he tells you about the vision for the Black Achievement Fund. I tell you now, if you're anything at all like me, as soon as you hear it, you're going to join. When I heard the vision, I said, oh yeah, that's it. That's the solution for us. Not only did I take out a personal membership, I took out a corporate membership for the African Village. So the African Village has joined hands with the Black Achievement Fund for the empowerment of our people. Got me? So come on, family. I wouldn't ask you to do anything I'm not going to do myself. Okay, come on, $9 a month, Black Achievement Fund. Go to baf.solutions and sign up. All right? Brothers and sisters, you guys have no idea how wonderful it has been being with you today. You know? Yeah, man. I love how you guys are growing, how you're learning. Thank you for all of the email that I've been getting. And you guys, you've been seeing the testimonies. I've been sharing the testimonies that I've been getting in the email on my Facebook page. From all over the place, okay? Yeah, so if you have a testimony to share about what this ministry has meant in your life, email it to me and I'll post it so people can see that the awakening is happening and it cannot be stopped. Got me? Okay, man. All right, let's get ready to get out of here now. Ah, yeah. The African in me loves the African in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. You know why? Because you're easy to love. Again, thanks to Brother Abid Satek out there in Los Angeles, California, for putting this track together for us. Thank you, Brother Satek. Let's do this, y'all. Come on. Everybody sing it like you mean it. The African in me loves the African in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. The African in me loves the African in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. You're easy. You're easy. You're easy, easy to love. Oh yeah, the African in me loves the African in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. The African in me loves the African in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. You're easy. You're so easy. You're so easy. You're easy to love. And through the principles of my art now, come on. The truth that's in me, love the truth that's in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. The truth that's in me, love the truth that's in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. You're easy. You're easy. You are so easy. Easy to love. Justice, come on. Justice in me, love and justice in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. Justice in me, love and justice in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. You're easy. You are so easy. You're easy. You're easy to love. Righteousness, come on everybody. Righteousness in me, love the righteousness in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. Righteousness in me, love the righteousness in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. You're easy. You are so easy. You're so easy. Easy to love. Let's close out with the African in me. The African in me loves the African in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. The African in me loves the African in you. That's it. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. You're easy. You're so easy. You are so easy. Easy to love. Easy to love. Easy to love. Ah, yes, man. You're easy to love, man. I tell you. Listen, I enjoyed being with you guys today. Thank you for being with me. And I'll see you guys next week. Take care of yourself. All right? All right. Be safe out there. Until next week, peace.